yourselves. Welcome to Bad Influence. In an exciting program today.
I'll be driving around the studio in my go-kart.
Thank you, Violet, but mind out for that. Table. A safer way to participate in the new Olympic sport of in-studio go-karting is on this 8-way VR system. Our main review this week is Rebel Assault on the Mega CD. Yes, sir. And Z drives around Silicon Valley in California, tries out next year's super consoles, and finds out why making games for them is more like making movies.
But first, 5 CD-ROMs hit the shops this week, all based on books from the publishers Dorling Kindersley. Amongst them is one based on this book, The Way Things Work. And a quick flick through will show that it's full of these giant pictures of inventions, and you can see exactly how they work from the diagrams. Now, on the CD-ROM, you start off on this workshop screen. There are lots of little animations you can trigger, like this. Sorry, I'm busy. Can you call me back later? But the main bulk of it is the A to Z of machines. You can find out about inventions from aerosols to zippers. Stopping on the way to see jump jets. And you can set off animations in most of them. For example, this is what happens when you turn up the heat on the thermostat. It's ever so easy to find your way around. There's this alphabetical line. I want to look up robots, so I can just click on R. Then click on the picture of the robots. Like the book, you get the diagrams, but unlike the book, you can actually see how they work. So here you see it demonstrating taking the costume off the mammoth, the skin off the mammoth, off he goes. As well as more humorous stuff, the serious stuff too. For example, here's a demo.
The operator can teach the robot directly.
So you see, it's telling us how a robot's got to be taught to do even the easiest of jobs. And that simple robots repeat a series of movements until they're stopped. You can even check up on inventors and the principles of science. So robots, industrial robots, are related to computers, so we click on that. Loads of different information, but unlike the book, we can even watch a movie.
I once came upon a forest mammoth who could both count and remember several numbers at a time.
It's a lot of fun, but for my money, I think I'd rather have the book. I mean, you can't take all this technical kit to bed with you, can you?
Ah, hello, Fertlers. I, too, am about to publish a CD-ROM. It's called Namrud's Fertling CD. It's got a few bugs in it at the moment, but I'll show you the intro section.
Hello, Fertlers. What cheat would you like to learn?
All you have to do is click on the game you want to cheat at. The only one I've got working at the moment is Tetris.
This is a cheat for Tetris on the Game Boy. It speeds the whole game up to expert level. On the title screen, hold down down and press start. Then, when the game begins, you'll see a small heart next to the level number to show it's worked.
Right, I'm just about to record another bit. Oh, by the way, Fertlers, when you record bits of video for CD-ROM, you have to do it in a special way, like this. This is a cheat for Sonic 6. On the title screen, hold down A, B, and down. Then when you press start, you'll be able to play the whole forest level as Elbows the Squirrel.
The best-selling CD this Christmas, I'm sure. Our first review this week is Rebel Assault on the Mega CD. You play a Rebel rookie pilot. The game has 15 levels, which include scenes from the first 2 Star Wars movies. There are some stunning intro and between-level sequences, which whet your appetite for a real Star Wars feast. But great movie sequences don't necessarily make for a great game. The big test is, how does it play? With the answers, Sir Hail.
The game gets off to a bad start where you test your flying skills in the so-called Beggar's Canyon. The controls are unresponsive and you'll die many deaths before you get anywhere. This is one of my favourite bits of the film, the snowspeeder attack on the AT-ATs. The graphics are quite good from afar, but when you get close to the AT-AT you realise how poor they really are. Another bad thing about the gameplay on this level is that you can't control where your snowspeeder goes, you just fire, which is really boring. There's one good thing about this level though, the sound effects and the music. This is the Stormtrooper base on Hoth, and basically it's just more shooting. Again, this level's really disappointing as you've got really limited control. You can only move left and right, you can't even move forward. I really wanted to like this because I love the Star Wars films, but it's just an average game that looks like it's been thrown together in a bit of a rush.
I quite like this. It's hard at first, but you pick up new skills as you go along.
I marked this down because
control system is poor, which I think spoils the playability.
And so the final scores for Rebel Assault, both the boys and the girls gave it a keep practicing, Luke, 3 out of 5.
So, 3 and 3 for Rebel Assault. There's currently a lot going on in a galaxy far, far away. The 3 Star Wars movies have just been released on video with new digital soundtracks. When the original films were made, the special effects were all shot using models and painted backdrops. Today, of course, most film effects are made using computers. So there are now plans to remake the special effects with computer graphics and re-release the movies. And producer George Lucas is currently working on 3 scripts for new movies set before the original Star Wars time. Games-wise, there are 2 exciting new Star Wars games to look forward to this winter. Dark Forces is also set before the movies. You play a rebel agent whose mission is to steal the plans for the as-yet-unbuilt Death Star. Your enemies are a terrifying army of robot stormtroopers. The game is fully interactive. You can move your character anywhere and duck, jump and look around. But Super Return of the Jedi is the one that SNES owners have been waiting for. The final chapter in the Star Wars trilogy features music and scenes taken straight from the film. There are new characters to control. For the first time, you can play Princess Leia. Here, she's putting up a mean fight against Jabba the Hutt's henchmen. Or you can swing through the forest as Wicket the Ewok, complete with Ewok-y sound effects. As with the first 2 Star Wars games, there's plenty of variety in the gameplay, including some very tricky flying sequences. Now, here's Z, who this week journeys to the heart of America's computer games industry to get the lowdown on next year's hot hardware.
This is Highway 101 out of San Francisco. If you follow it south for about 400 miles, you reach Los Angeles. But the stretch between here and San Jose is the famous Silicon Valley, home to America's high techies. 1994 has been a bit of a dull year for hardware. Everyone's been beavering away behind locked doors on 95 stuff, what you might call hopeware.
Sega's hopeware is the Saturn console. It's a 32-bit, very fast machine with software on carts and CDs, but no one's seen anything of it yet. Closer to reality is the Mega 32, called the 32X over here. It's an add-on for the Mega Drive that lets you upgrade to 32-bit and still play your old games. This should be out in November. Actually, this is a prototype. The game is really running on this development system.
There should be 6 games available for the launch, including this one, Star Wars Arcade, a fast action adventure. An even faster deluxe version of Virtual Racing, which has more tracks and a choice of 3 different types of cars. And there's this game, working title Meadowhead, where you play a futuristic cop in command of a giant mechanoid.
Further down the valley in Mountain View, the giant hardware company Silicon Graphics is developing the new Nintendo hopeware, the Ultra 64.
The arcade version will be released next June, with the home version to follow in October, priced around $250.
The games are being developed on these expensive supercomputers known as Reality Engines. And although nothing is finished yet, you can get a good idea of what they would look like from these demos.
This one's called Egghead Shred, a tryout for a lovable, if difficult to control, skiing character. And this is a very early demo of a racing game called Speedscape, which shows off the Ultra 64's ability to generate amazingly real-looking backgrounds.
Now, all this new hardware is giving software companies a headache. What machine should they develop for? If you add in the excellent Jaguar and the 3DO and CDI and the new Sony PlayStation, which is launched in Japan in December, it's a nightmare. And on top of that, the new systems demand much bigger and better games.
So here at the biggest game company in the world, Electronic Arts, they're now using full-scale Hollywood production techniques.
Hey, Ops, how about going around with me? Bet you a week's pay on one hand.
Thank you. No.
This is Wing Commander 3, The Heart of the Tiger. And it's not just a game, it's an interactive movie. 50 veteran Hollywood movie makers joined the techies to produce nearly 2 hours of live action, smoothly blended with the computer backgrounds.
Or his right eye, not the left.
The interactive movie features well-known actors Malcolm McDowell and Mark Hamill, perhaps best known before for his role as Luke Skywalker in the Star Wars trilogy. The animatronic co-stars were made by the special effects team behind the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and the whole thing had a movie-style budget of around $3 million.
I shall try not to disappoint you, old friend.
Brilliant. Now, I often wondered what happened to Luke Skywalker, but our Violet met him 2 or 3 weeks ago, didn't you?
Yeah, we were filming at the launch of that game, and he was there, and we asked him to say, "May the Force be with you," but he didn't want to say it.
Yeah, but if you've said it as many times as he has, I'm not surprised. Do you know who he reminds me of?
No.
Keith Chegwin. Now for this week's news and previews.
Another great classic from the early days of video games is being tarted up for release on console this Christmas. Factual, the Mayan adventure, is based on an old Atari game from the early 80s. The 94 version is a great-looking action platformer. You play Harry Jr., son of the original hero, who has to rescue his dad from an evil Mayan spirit. New improved Pitfall will be out on the SNES, Mega Drive and Mega CD later this year.
Baywatch meets Miami Vice in a new CDI and TV series starring Hulk Hogan. Thunder in Paradise is the story of some ex-Navy SEALs who've developed an invincible superboat called Thunder. Both the telly series and the interactive game promise thrilling action on the high seas, plus plenty of gratuitous shots of bikini-clad babes.
Dragon is the game of the film of the life of Bruce Lee. This is the SNES version of what is a massive new beat-em-up. It'll also be released on the Mega Drive, Game Boy and Game Gear. It boasts twice as many animation frames as any other fighting game, and there's the option for three characters to fight each other at the same time.
Hello, Furtlers. Which film is this an impression of? 15, love. You cannot be serious. That ball was out. Right, I've had enough of you arguing. Take that. Well, you take that. Did you get it, Furtless? It was the umpire strikes back. And here's a cheat for Super Umpire Strikes Back on the SNES. It lets you get loads of extra lives and power-ups. On the first screen, go past the big heart, then drop off the edge of the cliff and move left. You'll land on some invisible platforms. Now, blast around here to get your lives and power-ups. Hey, and now for another film impression. Oh, no, it's come back. I'll give you a clue. It's another Star Wars film. Oh, no, it's come back. You must have got it by now. It is Return of the Deadeye.
Not a lot you can say for that, really, is there?
Whoa, stop. Now, I think you've done more than enough damage for one day. Get out of that infernal machine. This is supercarts, which if you drive like Violet is considerably safer, so come and do some practice here, please. It uses a new graphic scrolling technique to bring added realism to racing games. Up to 8 different carts race against each other on up to 8 different tracks. 2 people can race against each other in split-screen mode, but the really exciting thing is this is the first computer game that lets you play against up to 7 other human opponents, including the British junior go-kart champions Gary and Luke. Link games are definitely the thing of the future, but how do they work? Well, not surprisingly, the computers are linked together using these leads. Each computer has its own address, a bit like a postcode, if you like, and the computers are constantly talking to each other, exchanging information all the time. This information is used to work out where all the other carts should be on the track. That's the techie stuff out of the way. The real fun tum is in the racing, and that gets even more realistic with the use of a few optional extras.
Yep, I'm using this Thrustmaster go-kart style steering wheel, and you've got this button here for reverse, and over here the stick you can use for power-ups, and then for the pedals we've got gas and brake, and you can even use the latest virtual reality helmets with it. So I put it on, I can now look round behind me and see the bad influence hoarding at the side, but no one's passing me, mate. I'm off.
The problem is not everyone's got the room to run 8 PCs and all the extras in their bedroom, but if you haven't got the space, don't fret, the game will run down a phone line using a modem. Excuse me, Gary, I've just got to show Violet how it's done. Are you ready? On your marks, get set, go!
Coming round the first bend. No one can see me for dust. I think I'm out in front, of course. Oh, no, all that someone's take in front of me, using his turbo.
Train hurtling off the bend here now. He's into a quick left-hander, changes down.
Coming up to the hairpin. Takes it beautifully. What a racing line.
The boy Crane on his final lap now. Just coming into the home straight. There's a car in front. Oh, he's passed him on the left. Oh, what a move. Oh,
and she takes the checkered flag. I knew all that go-kart practice would pay off. And now for some more games reviews. Fans of the Desert and Jungle Strike games have been waiting for this one, Urban Strike, for the Mega Drive. For those of you unfamiliar with the Strike series, They're sort of tactical shoot-em-ups, and you really have to pay attention at the briefing sessions if you're going to play the games properly. Here's Ian.
This has all the elements of the first two games. Great storyline, great strategy, and the added bonus of extra vehicles to play with. This is a Mexico level. I'm just coming up to a tank park here. Get into it by hot-wiring the tank, which is this part. You have to press button C. I learnt this from an information source earlier in the level. You have to use a lot of strategy to play this game properly. There's only just enough fuel and weaponry. So it's going to take a bit of time to kill all these ones. Unlike the first two games, you can get out of your vehicle and carry out attacks on foot. This one's supposed to be inside a casino. Unfortunately, when you do get out of your vehicle, the man's very hard to control. It's not outstanding, but it's a quality game. It'll last you for ages.
Plenty of strategy, but the graphics look like cardboard cutouts.
It's just more of the same. These games don't appeal to me, but fans of the Strike series will definitely love it.
And the scores for Urban Strike? The boys gave it an ammo dump in the Northwest Sector, 4 out of 5, but the girls gave it a not our sort of game, 3 out of 5.
Don't make me angry. You wouldn't like me when I'm angry. With those immortal words, the mild-mannered Dr. Banner turned himself into the Incredible Hulk and made himself the star of a Marvel comic strip and a teleseries. He's green, but is he fun to play? Here's Aisha.
Anyone who's prepared to pay £50 for this game wants their head examining. It's an old style of game with pathetic graphics and dull gameplay. Using a transformation capsule, you can turn from the Hulk into Dr. Banner, which allows you to get through tunnels which you can't get through as the Hulk. Also, this is the sort of game that you don't need skill to complete, just perseverance. The thing is, it's so boring you don't want to persevere. This is an example of how bad the graphics really are. You can't even see the Hulk when he's underwater. In fact, it's almost as bad as an 8-bit. I'd really like to give this game a minus score, but they wouldn't let me. It's not even worth a 1.
What a sad game. It's a perfect example of a tired style of game that should be banned from now on.
This is one of the most boring games I've ever played. The gameplay is dull and it doesn't even have good graphics.
And the scores for The Incredible Hulk. The girls gave it a don't make me angry 1 out of 5, and the boys gave it a too late 1 out of 5.
Furtlers, I have an announcement. The Force is with me, and I'm going to attempt this last cheat using mental power alone. It worked! It really worked! And now for the cheat, Furtlers. It's for Rocket Knight Adventures on the Mega Drive. It lets you get an action replay of the game you just played. Just pause the game and then press up 7 times and down. Then left 3 times and right. Now reset the machine. And there you go, a replay of the last game you played. Hey, now Furtlers, watch this.
Last week's competition prize was snares and a copy of Stunt Race FX. We asked you who won the 1994 Formula One Grand Prix. The answer is Damon Hill. We had 10,000 entries, but the lucky winner is Jonathan Banning from Reading. Well done. 10 runners-up get Bad Influence T-shirts.
This week's competition prize is a Mega CD with Rebel Assault and all 3 of the Star Wars digitally remastered videos. The competition question is, what's the name of Princess Leia's home planet? Give us a call with your answer on 0891-555-999. Call will cost you no more than 25p, but do please get permission from whoever pays the phone bill before you dial. Remember, you can't win if you don't ask permission, and we do check.
That's it for this week. Next week, we've got a great sneak preview of a new game to hit the arcades, Primal Rage. It's Jurassic.
See you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye.